guys for being here. Thanks for all the 9:30 people who are missing their regular Cracker Barrel routine for coming to 11 o'clock. It's been, I really thank all the volunteers too who got here early to set all this stuff up, but of course they're staying to tear it down. And we're doing this again next week, so we'll do it again, same place, right here. It's not going to rain next week either. I know everybody's worried because it looks like it's cloudy. I just pray that God would give us AC, and that's what he did. So it's nice and cool. It's nice and perfect. like he just does everything I say. All right, no. If you have your Bible, go to 2 Samuel. We're gonna finish the story. We've been talking about the ark. We've been talking about worship. We have been in a conversation about worship, trying to create a healthier culture of worship in our church, and we'll be talking about that this whole semester. We started a few weeks ago with the foundation of worship in a conversation about prayer, what it looks like for us to pray, how God wants us to pray, and that series was called Cry Out. But even as we talked about prayer, we know that even if we know how to pray, we can still let our junk get in the way. And so this series has been about letting go of all of that, finding the freedom to worship God the way that he deserves to be worshiped. So we started this looking at the Ark of the Covenant. And in the first week, we saw how Israel mistreated what was this visible representation of the presence of God, often treated as the actual presence of God. And they took it to battle like it was a magic toy plaything. And it was captured by the Philistines. And we learned in that first week that we can't treat God that way, that we can't just boss him around and have that kind of control. So we have to let go of our preferences. We have to let go of the way that we want to do it, the way that we think it should be done, and allow God to show us what his preferences are. That if we change our preferences to be his, then we're going to see what it looks like to really worship him. So prefer what God deserves is what we said the first week. So the Philistines take the ark. They have it for about 7 months, and it's plagues and devastation. And so they try to get rid of it as quickly as possible. It ends up in a guy named Abinadab, his house, and it's there for 20 years. And in that 20 years, David becomes king, and he defeats the Philistines, and he unifies the kingdom. And his first act as king is going to be to return the ark back to the Israelites, back to where he believes that it belongs, to God's people. But David takes 30,000 men, his armies, he's got musicians, the big fanfare, and he does it his way. He doesn't do it God's way, and then tragedy strikes. And we saw in that conversation that David tried to control the scenario. He was doing it his way. He wanted to be in control. He was king. He had just won a battle. He had just unified the kingdom, and he thought that he was on a roll, so why not, right? But he put the ark on a cart instead of carrying it by poles like it was supposed to, and someone died. And so we learned the second week that we have to let go of control, and that if God doesn't have your heart, he doesn't have you. And David started off being mad at God, but then he realized that he made mistakes. He saw the error of his ways, and so he went back and he took 3 months to figure out how to do it right. He did it wrong. There was tragedy, and now he wants to do it right. So last week we saw where David gathers the people. He calls everyone to Jerusalem. He calls the priests together, and he says, you guys need to take time to consecrate yourselves so you're ready to do it the right way. And we're gonna follow all the rules. We're going to do it the way God expects, and it's going to be right. And we saw that he had to make a lot of sacrifices, had to make a lot of changes. But if we can do that same thing, that's what we learned, that if we let go of something, let go of our routines, whatever it is, that we can begin to experience God the way that God wants us to experience him. And we said last week that every sacrifice moves us closer to surrender. And we saw how David, learning from his mistakes, he took the first time they went celebrating, and the Hebrew word there was soheching, right? That was the fun Hebrew word, which meant to mess around. And he changed that. The next time he said, we're not going to do that. We're going to simcha, which means to create a spirit of gratitude. And they did. Now, today, we're going to finish the story, and we're going to see that they bring the ark. They did it right? They took 6 steps, and they made a sacrifice, and they lifted it up, and they took another 6 steps, did it at least 7 times. Very grateful that God would allow them to do this, doing it right. And today, we'll finish the story when he returns the ark to Jerusalem, puts it in the tent that he had prepared for it. And so we're going to pick up in chapter 6 at verse verse 14. So they walked, they sacrificed the ox, they walked the six steps, they did it again seven times, and then here we go, verse 14. And David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was wearing a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the horn. And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. Let's skip down to verse 20 and go read those other verses later for time's sake. Look at verse 20. And David returned to bless his household. He'd come home. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, "How the king of Israel honored himself today, uncovering himself today before the eyes of his servants, female servants, as one of the vulgar fellows shamelessly uncovers himself." And David said to Michal, "It was before the Lord, and who chose me above your father and above all his house to appoint me as prince over Israel, the people of the Lord. And I will celebrate before the Lord. I will make myself yet more contemptible than this. I will be abased in your eyes. But by the female servants of whom you have spoken, by them I should be held in honor." Now, there are two distinct behaviors in here that we need to talk about today. As we close up this conversation on letting go, finding freedom, and worshiping God the way that he deserves, these two behaviors that we're going to see today really define how everyone worships. You're either one or the other. And I know that you're going to push back and say there's probably some middle ground, but if you'll follow me, you're going to see that it's really all in or it's not. There's really two distinct behaviors on how to worship God. So the first one we see, right, is talking about David. David enters dancing. He's shouting. He's singing, right, because he's figured out the right way. He's celebrating. We'll see in a second that this type of celebration is slightly different. It's a different use of the word than what we talked about last week. And I know that some people may have heard this story before and have heard maybe even just the idea that David danced in his underwear or that he worshiped with nothing on or whatever. And it says he was wearing this linen ephod. And I know that some people have said that it's like a loincloth or it's basically like whitey tighties. That's not what it is. In fact, if you can think of like a very thin robe and with just a simple covering over it, there are very distinct, specific instructions on what the priest would wear. And so they would wear this linen, thin linen cloth, and they would wear the ephod over it, which kind of looks like an apron. And then they had a breastplate, and they had a belt thing that's made of fabric. I can't remember what it's called. They had all these different things that they wore. And that was the high priest. And the other priest would basically wear very little, just this robe and then the ephod. And what David was doing was he was taking off all of the royal garments. He was taking off his crown. He was taking off insignia. He was taking off anything that made him look like he was king, so that he was not greater than anyone else there. In fact, he was following the same procedures of the Levite priests that he had consecrated themselves to go bring the Ark of the Covenant back. He was putting themselves in their category. Like, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to consecrate myself. As the leader, I'm going to set the example. And so he takes off all the everything that signifies him as king and basically makes himself no higher than anyone. And so David's approach was, I don't want anything to be a distraction to my worship of God. I'm stripping everything away so that it can be all about him. I want to be that humble, obedient servant. And everything else that can be a distraction, the crown, the royal garments, all of that stuff, when people see me as king, I'm not the central focus here. That's behavior number one. I'm not the central focus. I'm going to let go of everything else that could even possibly be a distraction, not just to me, but to everyone around me, so that God can be worshiped the way he deserves. Behavior number one. Second behavior is Michal, his wife, who looked out the window, right? Now, when I read that, the first thing that I think of is, why is she not out with everyone else? Why is she not dancing and singing? Why is she secluded herself? And if you look, it says that she despised him in her heart. David danced with all his might, shouted with everything that he had. She sees that and despises him in her heart. As she comes out to greet him when he comes home, she greets him with sarcasm. Did you catch that? Did you catch it? It's awesome. How the king of Israel honored himself today, right? Sarcasm. All right? We won't have any jokes about wives and sarcasm, but that's what she did here. And he kind of gave back some of his own shade, right? He's like, well, God appointed me over your father, right? He appointed me. Michael's attitude, Michael's perspective was not one to take everything away so that God is the central focus. She still wanted to be focused on. She thought that David should still want to be focused on, that he should still have the royal garb, that he should still present himself as king. That in her mind, that's what really mattered, that he could lead them and be a great example if he put himself out there as something better and more important. There's an author who wrote a book about this called John Clayton. He says this: this woman was part of the political establishment. Her father was king. This is all she'd ever known. She'd always lived in a political correct environment. When she sees her husband take off his kingly garments and crown and became like everyone else, and especially when she sees David participate in an undignified celebration, she is incensed. She is despises him. She has disdain and contempt for him. She is saying that royalty, in her mind, eclipses righteousness. And for her, there is personal ambition or personal gain or personal power, authority or something that should still be held on to that's more important than God. So those are the two behaviors. Do you see it? David says, I'm taking everything away. There's nothing that elevates me above anyone else. I'm going to the lowest level so that God is the central focus. And then there's the other behavior, which is not God is the central focus. That I am some way still in control. That I am some way still have preferences. That I still am holding on instead of letting go. All right? You see that? Okay. Now, David responds. He tells her basically that his duty is first and foremost to God when he says that he was appointed over her father, right? That's his shade, to be the prince, to lead the people. And when he says, celebrate before the Lord, it's almost the same word. It's another variation of the word salheking that we talked about last week, but this time it means find pleasure in. So here's what he's saying. He says, I will celebrate before the Lord, but he's saying that this now, I'm not finding my pleasure and just having fun, I'm finding my pleasure in worshiping God. Whereas before it was messing around and just having a good time, this time his saheking, using a different variation of the word, it's about finding pleasure in worshiping God. And he admits that as loud as he was shouting and as hard as he was dancing, and as it said, with all his might, he admits there's probably still some more that he can do. He says, I can be even more contemptible, undignified. The Hebrew word there is kolel, which means insignificant or worth less than something. So he's saying that I can even give God more. With all my might, I just danced. With all my might, I just shouted. With all my might, I just gave everything I had. But I can still give more. And when I do that, he says, that I will be abased in your eyes, which means to look down upon, or to seen as low. The Hebrew word there, shafal, means low. But the women that he's talking about, or that she was talking about, saying that he had embarrassed himself, he's saying, if I do this right, if I worship God correctly, then these people you're talking about that may have seen me as shame and dishonor, if I do it correctly and they're paying attention, then they're going to see how God deserves to be worshiped. And they're not going to see it as low and shameful. They're going to see it as high. That's what he says. He says, I shall be held in honor for those who get it. He's telling her that she doesn't get it. Which begs the question for us today, right? What behavior best describes how you worship. Do you dance with all your might? Are you more likely to shout and sing or look out the window and roll your eyes? Which of these behaviors best describes how you worship? Are you one who looks for every opportunity to let go of everything else so that God becomes the central focus? Or are you the kind that looks at others with disgust and disdain? Now, I know that you're like, there's got to be some middle ground in there, right? There's got to be some level, because I don't look at people with disdain. I'm not paying attention to someone who is worshiping different than me and thinking something negative like that, right? I know you're probably thinking in your heart, but listen, it's just at the two extremes, it's either God is the central focus or he's not. Because just test yourself. Don't answer out loud. Test yourself. We were just singing a second ago. We're going to sing again, right? You know it's coming. So if somebody were to stand up and shout and dance, run around crazy, fill with the Holy, don't do that if you're just goofing around, right? Don't hear what I'm saying. Fill with the Holy Spirit, genuine, and they were doing something that looked crazy, would you join them? Or look for someone to put a stop to it? Would you be grateful they had the courage to do something maybe that you didn't? Or are you going to roll your eyes and wonder what's wrong? Because those two extremes, God is the center or he's not, is really what we see in Michal, because when she says, David, you should have kept your royal attire on, when she's looking out the window instead of being a part of it, she is saying that she still wants some of the worship kept for herself. She still wants to have that control. She still wants to have those preferences. She still thinks that she deserves some of the worship. She thinks that she still deserves some of the accolade. Not to say that she's telling people to bow and worship her, but listen to me. If God is not the absolute central focus, something else is. And whatever that something else is, it's what's really getting your worship. You hearing me? So it's really one or the other. Am I saying that everyone needs to run around shouting? Everyone needs to be dancing? Everyone needs to be clucking like chickens and all the crazy stuff you might see on some TV shows, right? No, I'm not saying that. But I do think that there are some people here who probably should raise their hands. Not because that does anything special for you, but because you refuse to. Because it makes you feel uncomfortable. And you probably should maybe get out of your comfort zone a little bit. And maybe that's the thing you need to let go of. I grew up Southern Baptist. And when we had the music, okay, we sang hymns. That was it. It's the same like 8 hymns repeated like every week, right? Nobody clapped. Nobody did anything. We stood, we sang, we mumbled. We sat back down, that's it. I remember the first time that I ever raised my hand. I did it because I didn't want to do it. You hear what I'm saying? And the first time I did it, it wasn't because the Holy Spirit was moving me to lift my hand. I was like, yes, I did it because up until that point, I just didn't want to do it. And I realized that if I was truly going to worship God, I had to let go of something. So I let go. I was talking to my wife about this, and she said something very similar. She said the very first time that she ever raised her hands, someone told her to raise your hands. She said, okay. And then she did it. And then after that, it was like, you know what? I can do that. And it's not this forced thing. It's not this special thing that you have to do. But some of you probably need to do something just to get out of the comfort zone so that you can worship God the way he deserves. Some of you might need to sing louder or sing at all because you don't. Maybe it's because you don't think you know the words. Maybe it's because you don't like to sing. But I guarantee we can find a song on the radio. I guarantee you there's an artist somewhere. I guarantee there is something. If it comes on, you sing. And your hips might move. Some of you may need to dance. Some of you may need to stay seated and not stand up until God moves in your heart. And then while you're sitting there, wonder why it's taking so long. Some of you might need to shout. And it would be super distracting until all of us collectively can go, you know what? If that's genuine and he's allowing the Holy Spirit to move, God bless him. May the Holy Spirit move in me the same way. Because God deserves everything we've got. This is what I'm saying. If we want to create a healthier culture of worship in our church, then we can't do it the same way. We have to grow. We have to admit that even as David did, as much as we've been giving now, there's still more to give. There is still more to let go of. God deserves all we've got. All of us need to let go. It isn't just about singing, right? It isn't just about dancing. I don't know, we kind of box it in sometimes, but we've said this enough times. I know you guys know this. Worship is, it's about prayer. It's about reading God's word. It's about anything that we can do where God becomes the central focus. So I think about other things that we do as a church. We started this whole series when we talked about prayer. We asked people to commit to pray. But there are a whole bunch of you, right? I'm not calling anybody out because I don't know who you are, but you know who you are, who just didn't pray. Just didn't do it. And maybe that's the thing you need to let go of. Maybe that's the thing you're still holding on to. If you want one of those little paper journals and you want to start right now, we'll do it. We don't have to be talking about it for you to start something new. Maybe prayer is the thing you need to let go of, and you need to begin to have consistent conversations with God, praying with your spouse, praying with your kids. Maybe that's what it is. We did a study this summer on how to read the Bible. And we did that because there were several people who said they didn't know where to start. And they wanted to learn. It was short, 4 weeks, jumped in. It was a handful of people. But I bet there are a whole lot more people here who don't open this and read it, who could have been in that class. Maybe it might have helped them too. So maybe that's what you need to let go of. Maybe you're too intimidated by reading the Bible and you need to get into a class. You need to get with some people. You need to come hang out with us on Tuesday morning at Chick-fil-A. You need to get into a group or something to help encourage you, inspire you to open this up and at least understand it. Maybe it's getting around people, talking and building up relationships, friendships. Maybe it's getting involved with groups. You know, we did groups differently this semester for a variety of reasons. But a lot of people have kind of whispered, you know, man, we miss the way we did it, or we miss being in a group. We don't feel connected. All right, well maybe that's what you need to let go of. And you need to go just start a group. I mean, what's stopping you from calling four people and having them come over to your house and hang out? I don't know anybody. Maybe that's the problem. Go introduce yourself. Go shake some hands. Go hang out where people are. Maybe that's what you need to let go of. We have groups that are going on right now. But we have people who have organically said exactly that. There's women that meet Leslie Manis, women that meet at her house, Carrie Keith. Has some people that she meets and prays with. I know there were some guys that were coming up here on Saturday, Jeremy and Tad. The guys were like, hey, I just want to meet with somebody and talk. Let's do it. There was no official organization, a church. It was somebody saying, I need help, and somebody saying, well, I'll help you. And they got together. The Chris and Carrie Keith have heard conversations about from some couples saying, I could use some help and encouragement parenting. And so they decided to start a group. Starts tomorrow. They've got several people, but you might be sitting here going, all right, well, I'll start there. Chris Keith's right here. You can go have a conversation with him. He'll put you in the group. Bottom line is this. God is either the absolute center or something else is. And as long as something else is, God is not being worshiped the way he deserves. And we have got to let go, because God deserves all we've got. And as much as you think you're giving right now, I guarantee you there is still more to give. As much as you think you've done to grow, I promise you there's still more that you can let go. Me included. We're all in this together. In fact, I'm gonna push some buttons right now, all right? Everybody stand up. We're gonna close here in just a second. I don't have a watch. I have no idea what time it is, all right? But it's one service. There's nothing coming after this. Everybody just hang tight. Matt Law has no idea I'm about to do this, all right? We are going to do our best right here. Cars driving by, birds squeaking, there's stuff. Try your best to just ignore all of it. I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to focus in on God right now. However you want to picture him. T-shirt, blue jeans, giant white robe, beard, whatever. But I want you to lift your hands straight up, both of them, everybody. It might be awkward. I'm sorry. Do it anyway. Hold him up and sing with me. I surrender all. I surrender all to he, my blessed Savior. I surrender. Keep singing that. All to Jesus I surrender. All to he I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily. Lift it up. I surrender. I surrender. Oh. Sing it out. I surrender. All to the blessed Savior. I surrender. And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together. Mm. All together. Sing it one more time. Here I am to worship. Yes. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful. Father, with our hands raised high in absolute surrender and saying that we are here to worship, we're going to do that right now as we close this morning, this special time together outside. The beautiful weather, the cloud cover to keep us cool and comfortable. We don't even need all that. It could be blazing hot, it could be freezing cold. But if you are the center, we can give you all we've got. May you be honored as we sing these last couple songs. May you be worshiped the way you deserve. May we let go. We pray all that in Jesus' name. Amen.